Hey, you! I have got this great new device to improve the efficiency of your propeller. Why, my device can do anything. It slices, it dices, it even bakes bread. Fine. It's twice as efficient as anything else on the market out there. What, you say that's over 100% efficient? Buy today! Well, can you really believe my claims? Well, clearly not. But on the other hand, if I came to you and claimed that I could make small improvements to the propeller efficiency, well, that probably does seem likely. But will they work? Now that's a good question. Now, to evaluate all those claims, we need some sort of framework to understand how they might improve propeller efficiency. We need to go back to the basics, the underlying physics that go into designing propeller blades. Armed with that knowledge, we'll be able to appreciate the trade-offs of blade design and quickly discern which efficiency improvements are possible.
Spinning wings!
Oh, that'll make you dizzy. Okay, to generate forward thrust, the propeller blade works like a wing, only it's rotating. We use this same principle on airplane propellers, ship propellers, or even helicopter rotors. All propellers follow the same basic principles of a rotating wing. Now, before we can get into the design of propeller wings, we have to first focus on the direction of water velocity that the propeller blade sees. That's actually a bit of a complicated question. See, there are two components to the velocity. First, we have the velocity due to the ship traveling forward. But remember that at the same time that it's traveling forward, this propeller blade is spinning around very quickly. So if we were to take a slice, a section along the propeller blade, we would find that the velocity there was the addition of the spinning motion and the forward velocity. You add those two together, and that's the velocity that the blade section sees. That combined velocity is key because that's the flow direction that we have to design our blade section to. But there's a few complications to this diagram. This particular direction of water velocity only applied at one section of the propeller blade. As you move further out along the blade radius, that spinning velocity increases. So we need to put twist on the propeller blade and keep changing the shape to match the flow conditions at each section along the entire radius of the blade. This blade twist shows the first of many complexities and trade-offs that go into propeller blade design. So how do you design a propeller? Well, the design for a propeller blade consists of a series of blade sections, each stacked up to form the entire blade. Now, for each section, the designer has to consider a trade-off between three main elements: the blade section shape, the section size, and the angle of attack. And many other little things as well, but we're going to keep it simplified for today. The game is this. For each blade section, you're going to try to get the most forward thrust with as little drag as possible. So the designer starts by picking a blade section shape. These are usually standard section shapes that you can pick out of a book. They've been thoroughly tested and they yield predictable performance. But a shape just tells you a dimensionless answer. It's useless without answering the question of section size. So we know the blade section shape will determine the lift for a given blade size. So now the designer has to pick that size. They scale that section shape up to get the desired amount of lift from that one slice of the propeller blade. Now, in a perfect propeller, we would love to select a very large section size and pick very thin section shapes. That would be ideal for a very efficient propeller. But pesky reality bothers us, and it presents us with two problems. First, the blade section must be small enough to fit inside the propeller diameter. And second, the larger sections mean more surface area for skin friction. Skin friction slows down that blade motion and increases the propeller torque. That's a bad thing. We prefer to minimize that. The propeller designer must balance these different demands to get an optimum section shape. And we arm the propeller designer with a third tool when picking this optimization. That is the angle of attack. The higher the angle of attack, more lift gets generated for the selected section shape and size, but at the expense of greater drag. Designers typically prefer to keep low angles of attack, around 10 to 15 degrees or less. The wing sections are the most efficient at these angles. We also prefer these lower angles of attack for another reason, to get better use out of the blade section. Take a second look at that propeller velocity diagram. And this time, I want you to focus on the resultant force vectors in the bottom left corner of the diagram. That propeller blade generates lift at a right angle to the zero lift line for that section. But lift is not the ultimate goal of a propeller. See, we want forward thrust, and if we increase the angle of attack for this blade section, that lift force points further to the side, not forward. So higher angles of attack might generate more lift, but less of that lift goes towards creating thrust. So I have mentioned drag a few times in the propeller. How does that drag show up though in the overall propeller design? Well, we see it in two different ways. The torque required to spin the propeller and the swirl of water leaving the propeller. See, we knew the propeller wouldn't spin by magic. It requires a torque applied to the propeller shaft. This is where we pay for the propeller thrust. That torque comes from the drag of the propeller blade. But an equally important component is the propeller lift. Due to the angle of attack, part of the propeller lift points to the side, fighting the rotation of the propeller blade. Those drag and lift components add up to a huge amount of torque. In fact, you put more energy into spinning the propeller than you actually get out in terms of thrust. Wait a minute. If we put more energy in than we get out, where did the rest go? It went into the swirl motion of the water. See, when the water first enters the propeller, it moves straight. But after the propeller, that water has a strong swirling pattern. This swirl does absolutely nothing to help us. It's just wasted energy. Oh, doom and gloom, it's all bad news. Right, so how do we get back to the important question of how to improve our propeller? How to improve the blade efficiency? Well, there are two major efforts that really stand a chance to improve your blade efficiency. The first is finding ways to lower your velocity angle, as the angle of the water that the blade sees. You see, if we can lower the velocity angle, that means that more of the blade lift points in the direction of forward thrust. Always a good thing. Now, the way we generally do this is by putting some form of device in front of the propeller. And it's going, what that device does is it kicks the flow sideways. It starts it rotating at a shallower angle already. The other option is to somehow recover that lost energy from the propeller swirl action. The recovery devices generally look like some form of other propeller that's positioned downstream of the main propeller. Maybe smaller, maybe bigger. Now, don't forget though, for any of these methods, you still have to pay a drag penalty to pull that extra device through the water. So as with all trade-offs in propeller design, you can't get something without paying a penalty. Trade-offs. Propeller design is all about trade-offs. The designer tries to create the most efficient propeller possible. Now, the principal challenge to this is the direction of water velocity. And then the trade-offs of propeller blade design are complex, with many choices along the way. So to get from useless to a practical propeller, everything is a trade-off, and every little step has to pay a penalty with a loss in efficiency. So now that you understand all of those compromises, you are armed to better evaluate possible improvements based upon how they affect the propeller blade. Thanks very much. I'm Nick, the Naval Architect. Yes, we have reached the part of the show where I ask for tips. So please, hand me your tips. In this case, I just need you to click that little subscribe button. Subscribe.